You all think you know who Maya Lin is. You're going to find out something else. I've had the pleasure, and sometimes writing about art and writing about artists is, I mean, you're really interested in the work, and it's really great, you know, and I'm going to learn a lot and all this sort of thing. But sometimes a writer has the privilege of meeting an artist with whom you have this deep intellectual engagement, and you think you know something, and then you find out a lot of things that you didn't know to begin with, and you just keep going deeper and deeper. And that's been my experience with Maya Lin. I've been fortunate enough to work with her and think about her projects and write about them now for almost 2 years in several different essays. We've commissioned Maya Lin to make some works for this big exhibition about Lake Tahoe that Ann Wolfe is curating. It's a major art historical survey of the region this region of the Sierra. It's never been done before, and we're gonna put this survey across the entire museum for two floors. It's going to be an enormous project, and we'll publish a big catalog with Rizzoli about that. One of our six current book projects, I think, that we have going right now. And I realized, and so I'm out in a boat with Maya Lin, and we're on Lake Tahoe, and we're looking. I think she's going to want to know about bathymetry and, you know, all this kind of stuff related to some of the projects she's done, and she's looking at the wake of the boat, and she's fascinated by the wake of the boat. And that's the way I began my essay for this book that we're going to co-publish with Rizzoli about Maya's career this next year. It's a way into realizing how deep her thinking is, that she's thinking about waveforms, which is not a simple topic, as you know. Maya's just been awarded the 21st Annual Dorothy and Lillian Gish Prize. It's one of the most prestigious awards an artist can receive in the world. And it's in recognition of how her artistic excellence and public advocacy embodies the Gish sisters' vision to honor an artist who makes our world a better place. This is art that walks in the world. It's not just an artist making really interesting things about the world, it's an artist who is actually engaged actively with the world, which you might suspect, you know, for someone who has partially a background in architecture as well as in art, you might expect that would be true. Making the world a better place for art, architecture, and design is a large task, which is why my arms are continually slipping off the contours of her career. It's a big career. So I'm going to quote you something, just a little bit of something I wrote last year for an exhibition she had at the Pace Gallery. So, Maya Lin is inevitably cast as an architectonic artist, and given her training, that's true. She traces the lineaments of the planet in the materials and forms a builder might use. But her primary vocabulary is equally that of a cartographer, and her artworks have, over the years, taken us up the ladder of increasingly complex natural and cultural systems. Maps are static representations of change in elevation, contour, terrain, habitat. The juxtaposition of a rectilinear grid laid over the curving contour lines of a topographical map allows us not just to locate ourselves, but also to measure change over time as we update the maps. It's from this sense of cartography as a living discipline, a continually revising notion of the world, that Maya Lin comes to perhaps her most important work, What Is Missing, which she'll talk about at the end. It is my deepest pleasure to welcome my friend and colleague, Maya Lin.
Is this the clicker? Oh, thank you, Bill. Really enjoyed the program today. I'm a little under the weather, so if I sound a little like a frog, I'm sorry. I'm just going to start. There's been a lot of talk about water. I am actually too extremely obsessed with water. Don't know why, I've just always been drawn to it. And whether it first takes its shape after I've seen a photograph of a naturally occurring repetitive water wave called a Stokes wave, which came out of this really peculiar book called Van Dyke's Album of Fluid Motion, which I captured first in plasticine. My father was a ceramicist. I spent my childhood playing in his studio, playing in clay. So plasticine is a clay that never dries. It's oil-based. Just trying to understand that simple wave. And it turned into what would be the first of three earthworks focused on water wave motion. This one is 10,000 square feet. It's 100 by 100 feet. You could sit in a wave and read a book, so the waves are human in scale. As I say, just watch out when the sprinklers pop up. It's graced by the University of Michigan's North Campus Aerospace Engineering Building. So I would say I'm site-specific, but often my site isn't just the physical site, it's the context. So I talked to all the scientists, and that's what I learned, because again, this is aerospace. When I decided on that first image of the water wave, one of the professors said, well, that doesn't belong here. It belongs over in naval engineering. So from now on, when I talk to scientists, I say, well, I'm going to go fishing, I'm going to look around, I'm going to research, and I warn you, nothing of what we're going to talk about is probably going to make it into the piece, because I have no idea where I'll go with it. But this piece, and again, as an artist, I work in series, threes, fives. So the next piece started literally just as a simple sketch where at Storm King, there was a gravel pit that, is this a pointer? I don't want to point it if it's not. Oh, yeah, the red button. So the highway that was built went right here, and they dumped the gravel and the remains over here. So Storm King, the Andy Golds were the pieces over here, and they hid the kind of the brownfield gravel pit behind a big earth berm. So the last of the wave fields took and displaced the earth from the berm that hid the unsightly brownfield and became the artwork. Seven rows in the end. Scale got a little larger. What would happen if you could get lost in a wave? It's called Storm King Wavefield. And from two approaches, from the lower approaches, you walk through it. You're sort of obscured by it. And from the upper region on the highway side, you get to look down on the entire piece. What I love is it is a state EPA site. At first, Storm King was hesitant because they had sort of capped the site. But when the state EPA found out, they were so excited that an artist wanted to do a complete reclamation of a former brownfield site. So I try to use reclaimed materials in all my work. And if I can recycle a brownfield, I'm happier for it. That's just sort of how it looks in the winter. I just completed this piece. It's in New Zealand. It's called A Fold in the Field, though I do work in series, and I had finished those that were based right on a water wave. I wanted to create a piece that simply took a piece of paper and folded it and rolled it. And as an artist, just again, what this piece was a simple folded piece of paper, studied out, analyzed, built over a course of 3 or 4 years, actually. And the waves here, the rolls go about 60 feet high, and it was in a former exceedingly degraded pasture land. That was the first time I went there. I sank in the mud up to about over my knees. Couldn't get the boots out, actually. And that's sort of how it looks today. And it also, I play both inside and outside. There's a real dialogue between the outdoor large-scale works and then the interior sculptural works, like the ones in the gallery upstairs. This one's called Flow. It's made out of FSC-certified 2x4s, just put together in a continuous wave formation. And it took its shape from a larger piece that I had built for a show called Systematic Landscapes, where there were three main anchoring pieces in the show that got you back to an kind of a relationship to the land, one piece you walked on. So the idea was, what would happen if you took a hill and you brought it inside and you could let people walk up it and touch the ceiling? What I didn't realize is I pushed this one a little bit. It goes about 12 feet off the ground, and yes, you could walk up it if you signed a museum disclaimer and wore special booties. It was a little steep. But this one of the three was a piece that kind of was in between states. From the front side, it looked like a cresting water wave. From the back side, it looks like a hill. So it's a piece that cannot make up its mind if it's land or water. The other two pieces, again, one you walked on, one you walked through, this is a landscape very familiar to me. We spend our summers in Colorado. This is a mountain peak called Sneffels. It's a 14er. And what would happen if you just sectioned it apart and pulled the sections of topography apart? It's called Blue Lake Pass. And the last, which wasn't so much a mountain, but it is a mountain, I wanted a waterscape. But I also wanted something that would reveal both above and below water level. Most islands are mountain ranges. And so I looked and I looked until I found almost a singular point island. It's called Waterline. And in its first iteration at the Henry Art Gallery in Seattle, Waterline was balcony level. This was a double height space. And each one of these canyons was part of the Atlantic rift pushing together and popping up this one little island, which has led to the first of the permanent wire landscapes, which a commission at the California Academy of Sciences by the San Francisco Arts Commission allowed me to explore on the western terrace of the Renzo Piano building that he was working on, an idea of what if I looked at the entire mouth of the San Francisco Bay as it empties out. And it became another drawing in space made out of marine-based stainless. And you can now sit under it, eat your lunch, and you're under the terrain of the San Francisco Bay. It's called Where the Land Meets the Sea. Or another way I look at full bodies of water and rivers is in recycled silver. This is, again, just taking a look at the figure-ground relationship, the waterway of the San Francisco Bay as a singular whole. Or again, this one, a river. And again, I'm obsessed with waterways. Someone mentioned aquifers. That's on my list next of things that I will be looking at, all the endangered aquifers. This unbelievable idea, well, we're out of water. Let's just dig a deeper well. At some point, if you don't let it refill itself, you're going to be out. We are going to be out of water. So I've got some great maps that I've started to look at. So this is at the U.S. Consulate in Beijing, and it's a pin river of the Yangtze River. But what I think is really funny is rivers, again, we tend to think about where we are on the river, and when they get to be these very large river systems, do we really think about what's downstream from us, and maybe we only think about what's upstream if someone's polluting? And I've also cast that one in silver, again, recycled silver. So a lot of my work, as Bill mentioned, I am a little bit of a cartographer. This is the tallest mountain in the world. Anyone venture a guess? Oh, yes, it's Hawaii. So from tip to ocean floor, Hawaii beats Everest by I can't remember how many, like 100 feet or so. So again, maybe as an artist, I'm just a bit of looking at the natural world, but we get to look at it with topographic, scientific, sonar resonancing. We just get to look at the world with a 21st century lens, and I like to expose that in my work. So a show at Pace called Here and There, I literally took the latitude and longitudinal cross sections through the earth and turned them into these marble cut stone pieces, of which there's one upstairs, which is latitude of the Arctic Circle. So again, just getting you to see that the terrain, most of our mountain ranges, of course, are underwater and they're invisible to us, invisible to the human eye. This is latitudinally circumnavigating the world, with the intersection being the 44th parallel, which is where New York is, because the New York-based part of Here and There only focused on New York-based phenomena. or this piece that's installed presently at the parishes around the world times three. It's the Arctic Circle, it's going through New York, and then it's the equator. So as we think about climate change and we think about ocean levels changing, what will always be permanent, well, aside from our earthquakes, is the land below it. And it's the water level. If you imagine flooding this whole level and just understanding what would still remain and how much is in flux. Or for me, Hurricane Sandy, I saw this one photograph in the New York Times, and it's just a simpler way of data visualization. Amazing power of this flood plain of the storm surge of Hurricane Sandy, and I turned it into a Pin River drawing. Or again, this is the Hudson Waterway. And if we can just see the water as opposed to the land, whether it's in pins or in cast silver, I'm trying to get us to see these systems as interconnected wholes. Manhattan is a little negative space right there. See it? So again, it's amazing. We are so adept at looking at data and information, but sometimes we're a little bit stupid. We don't see it. We don't. The oceans, like, we pollute them. Out of sight, out of mind. It's a phenomena that is just part of maybe our psyche. So part of me wants to just reveal things that you know, they're in your backyard, you live with it, but maybe you're not really thinking of it. Or sometimes I choose these waterways because I just think they're stunning. Like, this is the estuary of the Lena River turned into, it almost looks like a brain cortex made out of pins. So these are my drawings. How does a sculptor draw three-dimensionally? As well as I've been very much interested in capturing things that change through time. This is the mean low ice the mean low ice area in the Arctic from the 1970s till today, cut out of one solid piece of stone with the sort of the receding layers. That one's also up in the gallery. Or I couldn't resist another Pin River drawing. This is called Where the Rivers Run North, and it's all the rivers that let out into the Arctic Ocean. I'm just gonna go back for one. As well as, you know, as we frack the Dakotas, there's all this talk about, oh wow, there's gonna be less ice. We can go up and drill in one of the most fragile ecosystems around. So I just look at this and I go, yes, we are that. I won't even say it. Thank you. Working on two, what I would call memorials, simultaneously, let's just say as a series, from Vietnam to civil rights to the women's table at Yale. The fourth is called the Confluence Project. I was actually about to start on a project about the environment, and I kept saying no, and then I think the governor of Washington, Governor Gary Locke, called up and said, would you just meet with them? And because I'd been saying no to a group that I thought was, oh, the guys that want to celebrate Lewis and Clark 200th anniversary, I'm not really a commemorative artist per se. I think I've been drawn to some of the major historical cultural shifts in our history, things that have shaped our whole growing up. And but the people that came to visit me were the tribal elders of the Chinook tribe, the Nez Perce, and the Umatilla. And all of a sudden I understood that what they said at the time was, we're not here to find someone to celebrate Lewis and Clark discovering an undiscovered land. We were there. And we'd love it if you would work with us to create something that addressed that as well. And I said, as long as I can equally be concerned about the environmental changes that have taken place along the Columbia River, I'll be there. So six stations, though that is the first map we ever did, so there are a few more possibilities. Stations along the Lewis and Clark Trail, some chosen for ecological reasons, others for historical, some because they were extremely important to the Native American tribes whose homelands we're in. And where do we end? Where Lewis and Clark ended at the Pacific, Cape Disappointment, near Astoria. This is what we were met with. Parking lots, restroom facilities, and odd manicured lawns and picnic tables. You know, it's going to play a lot with the fifth and the last of the memorials, what is missing, but I don't think anyone meant to obscure the fact that you couldn't even see the ocean anymore. It just sort of happens. I call it this unplanned sprawl. We've all been a part of it. It's all grown up around us. So the very first thing I had the State Park Service do here was we did a transit study. I know, not much what an artist would be doing normally, but and that's sort of what it looked like once we were able to convince them to reduce the size of the parking lot, remove it from this critical area, and restore this to the native grasses and sand dunes. And the amphitheater went from what I called Fred Flintstone, to like just a very simple arced path. There are two pathways, one that leads you to the ocean, which was Lewis and Clark's goal, and on it we've inscribed all their accounting of their entire journey. So even with that, you'll realize as you walk this path that you're not just walking into new land, you're walking through different tribal homelands. But what you might not realize is that the whole idea, the discourse, how Lewis and Clark looked at the land they were walking on is latitude, longitude, miles in, miles out, whereas exactly 200 to the years to the day Lewis and Clark arrived at this point, the Chinook tribe blessed the site for me. And they recited a poem. The tribal elder recited the poem, and in it, they said, teach us and show us the way to nature. So I love the idea of putting both pathways out. Both are just very different ways people have looked at and related back to the natural world. What you might not realize is that this oyster bed path follows the original water's edge before they put the jetty in and all that land had accreted. So we try to tell an ecological history of the place, so that's literally the original water's edge. And on the other side, yep, another parking lot. And the hedge was actually, we were beginning to deconstruct it, the hedge was about that high. You couldn't even, and it went all the way to the end. So what was one of our great estuaries of all time, the Columbia River estuary, you couldn't even see. And the Park Service was about to double the size of the parking lot. And lo and behold, one transportation study later, they didn't need it. So again, how much of the unplanned sprawl has happened in our lifetime, in all our small towns, medium-sized towns? And I don't think it's freedom because of the car. I think sometimes we need to have freedom from our cars. But this is now a naturally accreting wetlands. The water drains naturally and cleans before it goes in. And then, I mean, this was a complicated site. It was six different things in one. This is a fish cutting table that was there. And the funny with art, and again, as an artist, you're not gonna see a wave field here. I'm gonna step way back, because I'm in a park. I'm in a national park or a forest land or a state park, and my success is if I disappear and you didn't even know I was there, and the real artwork is putting you back in connection to the water that you came to see in the first place. So there's a little bit of a subversion here. I'm gonna check my artist head at the door and kind of quietly leave you a few things that give you an idea of where you are in the world. What I didn't know when I first saw that fish cutting table and knew that was the first thing I was gonna do was that the creation myth of the Chinook tribe whose homeland you're in is of cutting a fish the wrong way, and from the blood of the fish flies an eagle who flies to the nearby mountain that you can see right from this place. And when the eagle lays an egg and it hatches, it's the first tribe, the Chinook tribe. So as you're cutting your fish now, you realize you're in the Chinook tribe homeland. So just a little way of cluing you in. Second site I chose because I knew that the Forest Service had decided to blow the Sandy River Dam and let the Sandy River take its natural course, and I wanted to bear witness to that. So I put up a bird blind, and within it is cited every single species noted by Lewis and Clark, but also we tell you what the status of that species is today. And I'm just going to hop to the last, which we're working on right now. This is just the first conceptual model of it. It's an arced pathway that leads you to still water. It'll teach you the history, geologic, of Celilo Falls, the mythic history from the tribes, the time when Lewis and Clark barely made it over the falls with everyone, with the tribes watching and almost laughing at them, and a decision to inundate the falls with the last dam to go on the Columbia, the pleas from the tribesmen to not do this, which was their most sacred place. More water flowed over Celilo Falls than at Niagara Falls, and it disappeared within the course of about 5 hours. It's still under there. You just can't see it. So that arched bridge will end with silence. One passage will be left describing what it used to sound like, and then you'll be left with silence. So it's going to lead me to my fifth and last of the projects called What is Missing, which I'll warn you, it is a complete work in progress. I wanted to say when the two were talking about the Venn diagram and the earlier iterations, I started What is Missing maybe 25 years ago just by clipping information about extinct species, knowing that I would probably, my last of the memorials would be one I would call into being. So I've set up my own foundation called the What is Missing Foundation, and even though I say it's my last memorial, I'll probably be giving to it for the rest of my life. But it started in earnest with a grant from the San Francisco Arts Commission, where I put in the wire landscape, but I channeled most of the monies from the commission to the first iteration of What is Missing. And I'll get to that in a second. What is it? I don't know what it is yet. It's still growing. What if a memorial could jump form? What if it could be like water? What if it could flow to as many sites as it's invited in? What if it could exist both permanently as well as temporary exhibits, as well as what I call the Smithson non-site, the website on the internet, which acts almost as a nexus for the whole project. So I'm just going to walk you through where we are now. It is very much a work in progress. Thank you. So we've produced about 70 1 to 2 minute, almost like haiku tone poems. I deliberately, you hear it before you see it. It's blurred. You start reading it first. I'm trying to arrest your visual sense for just a minute. We quote from environmental groups, organizations. I'm a recycler. I gladly took footage donated by National Geographic, the BBC. Cornell Ornithology Labs is a really strong partner. They have one of the largest sound libraries, so we're working with them constantly. And the very first iteration is on the opposite side of the terrace from the wire landscape at California Academy of Sciences. I call it a listening cone. Couple funny things. I kind of like the balance of the two works on both terraces, but then how do you put videos out of doors? So in comes the RCA Victor, listen to the earth cone, and kids love to sit inside and watch the films. But it also exists as a temporary traveling exhibition called The Empty Room. You give me a black box theater, we hide projectors. You pick up a little optic piece of plexi and you get to hold a species or place in your hands. We have about, as I said, 70 films, and that's an ongoing process. We'll keep growing that library. We just created for Cornell a sound ring, and they'll keep making different soundscapes of habitats, endangered habitats from around the world. Creative Time got me the MTV billboard in Times Square for the entire month of April a few years ago. I do tend to surface on Earth Day because this is my volunteer project. So I basically, every Earth Day, I'll show up with more stuff in development. So this again is from IUCN. This is where we're at right now, and my focus is on protecting habitat. So, of course, it's not just the species, but the habitats they need for survival. But then, as an artist, I am trying to get you to think about things you might not be thinking about, like literally how much we've overfished and taken out a lot of our macro-charismatic large-scale species. Or, for that matter, the phenomena of shifting baselines, or, as Jared Diamond called it, landscape amnesia. We don't recall. We don't even realize what's missing, because with every successive generation, we get used to a more and more diminishment of the natural world. So in 1895, a cod, an Atlantic cod, was bigger than a man, and we've basically, every generation accepts a smaller and smaller amount. These are bison heads. What you might not realize is that we're just as many or more pronghorn antelope that roamed the prairies, and that there were many more. Some people think twice as many, like 120 million are some of the estimates, for the amount of sea turtles. So when Christopher Columbus first sailed into the Caribbean, he thought he had run aground. He hadn't. He had run into a sea of turtles. So if you go to the website, and I will warn you, it's not HTML yet, so you still have to go to your computer. When I started this, what I had wanted to do with the motion graphics just wasn't available. We're converting that right now. It is a work in progress. It is a little unusual for an artist, especially like when I work, I usually finish. But we're building it in full view, and we started with the past, what we're losing. We linked very carefully to the present, which I'll go into. But in the map of the past, every dot represents a story of the natural world. Some of them are historic. You can go in and find something from Columbus, from Julius Caesar. Plato, I think, is one of my earliest accounts we found about deforestation in Greece. There are wormholes. So if you go to a bigger dot, it's either a video, or you can study an entire history, ecological history of a place. And we're trying to get both historians to help build these, as well as audiences to donate their own personal memories. something you've personally witnessed diminish or disappear from the natural world, so that we can grow almost a global memorial to the planet. You can click on view in time, and all of a sudden all those dots will jump the line and give you a timeline history, as well as you can sort. So if you just want to look at extinct, if you just want to look at mammals, you can just play with it, give it time, and I promise you by December it'll get a little simpler. Right now we have historical quotes, personal memories, we've linked to over 40 environmental groups, we've researched the great environmental successes through time, as well as disasters, and all the videos are posted. And these are some of the things that we've found. Adrian Vanderdonk, as he explores the New York Harbor, lobster is 6 feet long, oysters 12 inches in diameter. So we also are doing wormholes of salmon and the collapse of salmon, oysters around the world. There is an incredible wealth of information, and we're mapping the ecological history of the planet, and volunteers giving info is more than welcome. This is one of my favorites, sturgeon. They were so common, they were nicknamed Albany beef. And ships had to avoid colliding into them when they went up the Hudson. Or this came in from someone in Rhode Island about having dinner on the ice in Narragansett Bay. Hasn't been seen since the 70s, or from Korea. So again, I urge you, go to the site, whatismissing.net, share a memory. We've also started working with secondary schools. Our first case study was with the Dalton School in New York. Disclosure, one of my daughters goes there. And WGBH got wind of it, so they're very interested. But what a perfect thing to let juniors in high school interview their parents and their grandparents, but also research their own hometown. And what we'll be doing next is linking so that the homework won't just be to research the ecological history of a place, but choose one or two local groups that you'd like to volunteer for. So it's linking to the present, and it's the future that I'm building right now, which will take me another 2 years. These are some of the quotes in. So over 40 environmental groups have shared what they're doing around the world. We've also taken these timelines and exhibited them at different exhibits. And there were two things that I started working with Bill on at Nevada. I wouldn't say I have pushed it into what would be my art. It's like, I know I compartmentalize myself between the architecture, the art, the memorials, a little kooky of me. So Bill and I talked about creating some of the videos. So the first intro video is something new that I made possible because of the Nevada Museum of Art, and I'm now working on some things that will play with what I started, which is sort of motion dot graphics of different animals. But what I'm interested in doing is almost abstracting species, both sound and motion, and I haven't even begun this yet. Because we're beginning to track and strip bare and almost understand simple animal movements. The future, where I'm at right now is very information-based. So you've probably all heard this before. If we all consumed like Americans, we would need 5 planets. So you could ask the question a different way. How many Americans could live upon the planet? So green print, which is all about reimagining the future, plausible future scenarios, takes 4 different parts. What you can do, most of it's on the web right now. From that, we'll get to save the planet diet, because who doesn't like to try to diet? Lose 10 tons, 10 pounds, add 10 years to your life, and save the planet. And right now, we're playing with what ifs, which is kind of macro scale thinking of how we could solve this, and then mapping the future will be much more technical. And I hope to rely on a lot of the presenters whose work was fantastic that we saw today to collaborate and help out here. So green print, envisioning a sustainable future. It will look at how we live, where we live, and what we spend our money on, It will shrink our agricultural footprint, our urban and suburban footprint. I've come up with the phrase, let's sprawl up. It will examine our industrial footprint and best practices around the world. So these are some of the what if that we're beginning to visualize now. And one of the key things is, what if by protecting more habitat and restoring habitats, we could reduce both our greenhouse gas emissions and create enough habitat to restore and protect biodiversity? So I'm not trying to act in the same world of the NGOs. I think they're doing an incredible job. What can an artist do that's slightly, maybe slightly different? And maybe we can just pose it in a different way. So what if the entire world, 7 billion of us, lived at the population density of Manhattan? How much space do we take up? Don't all move to Colorado. But but this I think is where maybe art can get us to think about this not as the insurmountable problem that we all think it is. We fit into the state of Colorado if we lived at the density of Manhattan proper, which technically isn't that dense a city compared to like Mumbai or Rio. So we're now crunching numbers and on mapping different cities around the world. But the idea is, it's really not about population alone, it's about our resource consumption and land use. And just remember the parking lots. I don't think we meant to put parking lots in front of great national park waterways. They just happened. But the good news is, nature's a little resilient. Yes, we've beaten it down, but if we give it a chance, we can bring it back. Power of cities. 50% of us live in those major cities right now. By 2050, 75% of us will. So re-envisioning what those cities are, but again, you can't just re-envision the city proper. You have to figure out how to feed that city, where the energy's coming from. So it's basically what Eric Sanderson says, inputs and outputs. So I'm gonna be kind of wonky for another 2 years, just doing crunching of numbers and beginning to understand what our patterns of consumption and energy and transit use are. Stepping back again to the big what if picture, this is what I know, sorry, had to do this. Curbing climate change, according to the World Economic Forum, would cost about $700 billion annually, and so I couldn't resist. These are some of the things we spend our money on. So take your pick. And my attitude is, as we sit here and we're fracking because it's a little bit cheaper than solar panels, because we haven't spent the time to subsidize the solar panel industry the way we subsidize the oil industry, the gas industry. We're sitting here and we're basically spending our kids' and our grandkids' future. Or according to the UN, we could mitigate climate change and probably boost our economy in the process, but why are we fighting it? And yes, we have a huge stagnation, or actually it's not stagnation. We're right now searching and finding the amount of money being spent by the big industries that would rather maintain course just a little bit longer. I don't think we have that time to maintain that course. So we also have started tracking, according to Lester Brown, this is what it would take to basically restore biodiversity enough, and then we did some more tracking on, like, if you wanted to protect all biological diversity, $76 billion, which is the pet industry worldwide, or just a bare minimum, is equal to business entertainment in Japan. Don't ask me what that is. Or restoring fisheries, which again would feed so many more billion people, 203 billion, which is equivalent to smartphone sales. Or I love this one, stabilizing water tables, 10 billion, which is oddly equivalent to what we spend on bottled water. We are spending this money every day. And I think there was a question earlier today about how do we take our economy today, and this will require the economists, because you couldn't stop it tomorrow. We have built up, and especially America and China wants to take our lead, we have built up our economy on disposability and obsolescence and on buying. We weren't like that. If you're old enough to remember, when the Bic pen first came out, it came out with refillable cartridges because it's right after World War II and no one would buy something and throw it away. So they have exactly where they wanted us to make a ton of money, and it's going to take a little bit of time to figure out how do you regroup? Don't know. Those are the volunteer economists we really need to begin. But just this, hopefully I'm saying, let's take the macro picture and get a good look at what we're doing. And we are looking at individual consumption and what each one of us can do. So just to wrap this, because I know I'm running a little long, the lawn is the largest irrigated crop grown in America, but what you might not know, more gas is spilled each year refilling lawn equipment than was spilled at the Exxon Valdez. And this is the amount of top fertilizer, pesticides, and the water usage going into them. And this is giving half your yard back to nature, and then we'll link to, our idea is to link to as many groups and showcase what they're doing. So there's a society called the Perfect Earth Society, and they'll give you an idea of what it would take to make the rest of your lawn a natural, safe, non-toxic lawn. Or 25 cents a cup difference between shade grown versus traditional, look at the number of species. So with every what you can do that we've got up, we link it to all the areas that you're affecting by supporting an organic, sustainable methodology in less than 1%. So we can change the market there. Each one of us can. So what each one of us can individually do is critically important. Couldn't resist, of course, we had to look at meat, and did we all know that the rabbit was unbelievably efficient, and a lamb is not, by the way, didn't know that till I did this, and of course it leads you to the logical conclusions, you end up down at bugs. Not one of my favorite proteins, though one could argue over 50% of the world relies on it, as do we, because there's a set amount of percentage allowed in our food. But what you might not realize is how much fish we feed our chickens, our pigs, and our farmed fish as we sit here having overfished the oceans, at which point I think there was a TED talk where someone said, the fish are tasting like chickens and the chickens are tasting like fish. And for me, those are three things I'm going to ask you guys to take away. Only buy organic teas and coffees, eat lower down the food chain, and don't touch the Atlantic bluefin tuna. It's the lion of the sea. It's an incredible animal. And after Japan and Spain, we're the top consumer of it. And unless we stop it, it's going to go extinct. It's an incredible animal, and as someone, I was at Berkeley the other day, eating a tuna because they farm it, but they can't breed it, so they catch it, so they take the stocks out of the ocean so they can't breed anymore. Eating a tuna, the amount of feed that goes into feeding that tuna isn't as if you're eating a lion. You're eating the predator that is eating the predator that ate the lion. That's far how far up the food chain you are when you eat one of these top predator fish. Oops, that was out of order, but we know that. So again, you'll get down to meat and habitat and the amount of land required on a vegetarian versus a meat. I believe in Michael Pollan's comment, eat food, not too much, mostly plants. Treat meat as a side dish or go vegan a few times a week if you don't want to go vegan the whole time. But we just begin to compare different areas required to grow. And we're also looking at how much, as far as efficiency, sorry, I have to split this slide like this, the amount of yield if you do an integrated farming versus, or a polyface integrated versus conventional monoculture. So we're starting to look at, what if you reduced your meat intake by 20%? How much land does the world free up? Couldn't resist that question. It's equivalent to all the protected area in North America and half of South America. So this is a serious amount of acreage. And what I didn't realize when I started this is wetlands sequester 3 times as much carbon as tropical forests. So as we talk about protecting and restoring our wetlands as a buffer zone to higher seas, we can also have a significant impact on reducing climate change gases. So that's according to the Land Art Generator, another really interesting group visualizing. I kind of took their data and then revisualized it. This is what it would take to offset the entire carbon footprint by growing forests and grasslands. And I'm going to end with one last video. Thank you. you guys want to do? You've been sitting a long time. Yeah, stand up.
Again, we have to use the mics because no one else can hear you in the other rooms unless we give you a mic. I'm just going to let you.
Whatever, yeah. Okay.
Your voice is.
It's lowering by the minute.
So I have a question in regards to an issue that these same issues about pollution, global warming were brought up in the early 70s. And in Time magazine and Newsweek, they discussed that the solution to everything was zero population growth. And if we were at the population of what we were in the 1970s, most of these issues would be close to non-issues, or 40-50% less than we are today. So why isn't we, in all of these topics that we see, why isn't there any mention of population control?
I think population is one of the factors, but what I'm trying to prove, it's like, I would say, as we get more affluent, we can consume like Europeans, we can consume like Northern Europeans, we can consume like Americans. It's not the only driving factor. And I think what you have right now is you'll be tracking as Africa really begins to develop, as China is absolutely developing, as India is really developing. We have the people, and they haven't even begun to consume like the developed world. So I think there's going to be a very complicated layering of different technologies, since we're already at 7 billion, and basically we're heading to 9 billion before we even begin to stabilize. So I'm actually going to be trying to play with the 9 billion number population. Technically, what happened was there was a huge scare in this country after the 70s. Everyone was like, the world's going to end, the world's going to end. People in this country, environmental groups, do not focus as much on population. They absolutely do in Europe. So it became a little bit of, I think, a political hot potato. They don't talk about it as much. I'm still thinking, well, do the math. We're heading toward 9 billion. We have to feed 9 billion people, and we have to ensure that probably, say, 20 to 30% of every landmass continent sets aside enough of its land to support biodiversity. Because as the second Stern report said after it dealt with climate change, it said, if you think climate change is bad, wait till we crash all of biodiversity. So I'm just trying to combine the two and head off what would be like, let's solve climate change linearly. We can maximize carbon absorption in some of our habitats, but we'll sacrifice all of biodiversity, at which point we'll never make it up. So I'm trying to say the habitat and species groups have to kind of combine and almost jump on the bandwagon, and that's the whole save two birds, it's the twofer idea. And maybe you're not going to maximize your return, but I don't think it's a good idea to try to maximize returns on nature in this end. And I think, just like there's this great fish farm, aquaculture in Spain, I think it's called, I'm blanking on the name of it, but they basically got a bird sanctuary, and they lose 10% of their fish to the birds, and that's fantastic. They have one of the healthiest systems out there, as well as the fish taste great, apparently, and they've also created one of the largest bird reserve areas in there. And so that's what I'm going to be trying to do, is just show that balance, step us back a little, and basically, you kind of, the industrial idea, which the first time industry and nature came together was the sealing industry, the whaling industry. They don't go together. Sorry, maybe one more question. I think that's it. Oh, one more.
Tell us about your staff, your crew.
My crew is tiny. I have five staff, architects and artists. I love RISD kids. They tend to be able to do both the architecture and the art. I call them ambidextrous. And like on the architecture hat, I'm building out a very large research facility in Cambridge, Mass. As well as on the art side, I think I've got six exhibits going around. And then I've got three part-time assistants that help with what is missing, but that means, like for the last image, I did work with Radical Media. Brian Eno gave the donated the music. The reason it was all those different parks and all those different worlds is it debuted at COP15, so I wanted to make it more of a global approach. I called up Red Burns when she was alive at NYU, and I've got a great crew of freelancers. So it really is my guerrilla art project, and I bring in the right freelancers. The website was done the same way, and it's pretty much grown organically in New York City in my tiny little studio. You're welcome.